Okay. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the launch of Grandad, You're Not Painting Between the Lines. Appreciate you coming out in such large numbers to support Dad. My name is Kevin Marshall, in case there's any confusion. As you can tell, I'm much better looking but and younger. So what we're going to do tonight is I'm just going to say a few words. I'm going to introduce Andrew, who's going to actually launch the book, and Dad is going to read a couple of chapters, and then there's a presentation at the end. That's it. So we'll get you out in time for EastEnders, or when the wine's gone. I was in Seattle about 10 days ago, and I read the entire book on the flight over very quickly because it's a very easy read. And it brought out huge memories, because most of the stories, we'd grown up with a lot of them, particularly the ones around Clonmel and the civil service, which I'll make reference to later. And then, of course, there's obviously some stories that pertain to Deirdre and myself in Boston with the children. And of course, our eldest child, Heather, who gave Grandad the title. So we thank her for that. But I suppose the most important thing that struck me about the book is that it's a collection of stories, and very important stories. And they're written, they're now published. In lots of cases, there are great stories that families have and they're not written. This one is written. And three in particular I'd like to draw attention to that just struck me, that made resonance with me. The first one is in chapter 6. It's called Cycling for Inspiration, and it pertains to my grandmother, Dad's mother, about being asked by, before my granddad, to for her hand in marriage, and actually not saying yes, cycling 20 miles to Mount Mellery to spend some time there thinking about what the right choice was. Now, that was in 1936. She was 24, and I was just, what struck me was the maturity of the woman at that time to actually take the time out and think about that, because unfortunately I knew her as a much older lady. But the other thing that struck me is, I don't know where anyone cycles, but there is one bitch of a hill up to Mount Mellery on an old rally bike. So I thought that was quite amusing. The second piece I'd make reference to is The Fortress, which is chapter 11, which pertains to 100 Amiens Street, where in 1957, Dad started in the civil service. But we passed recently, coming back from Croke Park after the match. Now, we're in Kilkenny, so I don't have to make reference to which match, which will be played all over again at the weekend. But it's quite, I hadn't read the story before it actually we'd gone after, gone, come back from the match. So it is, it's remarkable the way you have a different perceptive of a building once you think about what happened and what went on there. And the other thing that struck me is about the different time, you know, how employees or individuals were made welcome or not made welcome into various organizations. In that period of time, and I reference that to my current role, where we do hire a lot of graduates and we take a different approach to how we inculcate them and take care of them within organizations. So in that, there is a there's quite a decent social commentary on the nature of work. And the final piece, before I let Andrew take it further, is the chapter 37. There are 44 chapters in all. Running for Glory or Survival, which pertains to Dad's long running career and a number of marathons. And there is a picture in the book of the New York Marathon in the mid-80s with a time of 3:55, under 4 hours. Now, personally, I'd love to be able to achieve that time, but I think that's past me. But I think there's a lovely quote in the end talking about how running and squash together with the placid nature of my mother kept him sane all these years, and not a bad combination. So there are my little small reflection, and there's more. But with that, I'll ask Andrew Small, writer, artist, general all-rounder, to introduce the book. Thank you.
Wow. This book, incredible memories. In fairness, ladies and gentlemen, the cover says it all. A young man riding the bike into the river shore, huh? For a bet of 10 shillings. Do you remember 10 shillings? No, nobody here remembers the old, no. Incredible, yeah. I think it says a lot about the author, in fairness. A man who sees things, and so also the title, Grandad, You're Not Painting Between the Lines. Yeah. This is a man who sees things from outside in and inside out, okay? Who is a very inspirational man. A man who is big into memory, big into people. Okay, these ancestors and people that he mentions within the book forged this man of who he is today, including his family. And it's just an incredible read. And what I'm going to do, I'm just going to take one episode, and it's actually not a coincidence, Kevin, that I'm taking chapter 11, which is Into the Fortress, which you mentioned. I'm just going to read just one small piece of it, okay? Gives you a little taste. Obviously, you're going to read it for yourselves. And it's set in the Foreign Parcel Post Depot at 100 Amien Street in Dublin. Okay. What am I going to do with him? Why'd you always send the shagging rookies here? This was the staff officer, a small bearded Mayo man, talking to a colleague in the custom house. I remember thinking that a dog would get a warmer welcome. He ushered me into an enormous room, almost the size of a football pitch, and my heart sank. I'll never forget the moment. This is the main customs floor, and the post office authorities are responsible for producing all mail from abroad for customs examination here. Duty is assessed as appropriate, and the parcels are then delivered by the post office. That was my official instruction, but I didn't realize it. The place was littered with metal skiffs, all half full of parcels. These were being slunted around by men in long yellowish dust coats. The sunlight beamed in through the glass roof, revealing the floating dust which permeated every inch of the room. Along the wall on both sides of the room sat many more men, all wearing suits, with heaps of documents in front of them. There was a conversational hum, but it was overridden by banging of skiffs and parcels. There was a kind of staleness about everything. I'll leave it at that for the moment. And a passionate writer, a man who recognizes culture and character. But of course, the cover, inside and inside out as well, says it all. But you know, memory is a very powerful thing, as we all know. And I've always been very interested in memory, the creation of it, also the recognition of it, of past. But I also know that today is a memory too. And that's a serious thing to be involved in. Indeed, for me, an honor to be involved in. And that I am now helping to forge that memory for Frank. And that's an incredible thing to do. And we all can relate to that with Frank. We can all, as family and also friends, connections, we can relate with that with Frank. And so I'm very interested in the memory, the retention of memory, and also recall of memory, and also respecting everyone who's in this book, who actually now have created those memories for Frank. Of course, the word and the intention of the word. I'm very much into the power of intention behind the word, and also the caliber of the word, okay, which is a reaction which we all get, which centers within the heart and then enables us to reason and then live this with Frank. And as you read this book, you too will be affected by that vibration and caliber of his word. Okay, for now what I'm going to do, I'm going to read a poem which I composed It's about Frank. As I mentioned earlier, the intention is strong in my world, and I actually feel that I had Frank in my mind while I was composing this piece. It's not about the book, it's more about the man, and I think certainly about the man who is inside as well. It's called Shorelines. Moving haze breaks the dawn. Life cries many melodies upon the early breeze. The solitude of the wave, unborn, waiting to belong. Reaching the shore, it finds its calm. The glancing smile upon a child's face, spinning stone with screams of delight, sweet timeless memory of laughter. Warmth of the sun upon your brow, passing feather upon the air. Voices echoing greeting, passing the moment of the morning. Thank you. And so I really do wish, Frank, my heart self wishes that the book be open for you, for hungry readers. And I know everyone here supports me in that, and that to me is the biggest intention. Thank you.
Thanks for coming, folks. You're very welcome. It's humbling to see so many people here. I thank Kevin, my son, affectionately known as Big Bye in the old days, and I thank Andrew, both of them, for their comments and their commitment. I've never had a poem written about me before. I'd say there's a lot of stuff might have been scrawled about me, but not a poem. So I'm grateful very much. I have three special guests here. The first is Heather Marshall, my granddaughter, who gave me the title of the book, as Kevin said already. She denies it vehemently now, but she denies most of the things I say. But we have deep affection for each other. And I remember the moment particularly when she admonished me for not painting between the lines. I thank her brother Liam. He gave me the title of one of the chapters. There is a photograph at home on the wall which shows him sitting on my lap. I have the pipe firmly in my gob and I'm pointing to the birds in the air. And he looks up at the photograph sometime after 2003 or 4 and he says, "Pipe all gone, Grandad. No more fire." He never mentioned it again. As kids seem to be able to just write something off in one sentence. I thank Marie, my beloved wife, for the endless listening she's done over the years, not only to this project. And that's a genuine thanks. I thank my brother Oliver, and we're glad that he's here. I thank the patrons, Eamon Langton of this establishment, and my friend Johnny Hughes, a friend of 57 years, folks. I thank Sean Reed, the manager of this house, and the way he's looked after me. I thank Marie's family, her sisters and their husbands for coming. I thank Trish and Marion. And I thank my editor, Brendan O'Brien, who hung in with me over the last year, got me over the line, and I'm eternally grateful to him. I thank Tommy, the video man, and Jane, the musician. And last of all, but not least, I thank Niamh, our daughter, who at 8:20 last Monday morning appeared in the room and said, "Hi, Dad." Having travelled for 24 hours, roughly, from Vietnam. No one said a word to me that she was coming. I literally got a physical shock. I actually had to sit down. I was delighted, of course, and we're glad she's here. We really are. I'm not going to say too much about the book, really. I just give you a flavour of it and leave it to you. Let you know how it emerged. It emerged initially as about 27 pieces I wrote for RTE, for The Quiet Quarter, on Lyric FM and on Sunday Miscellany and The Living Word. They weren't intended to be part of a book at all. But my brother Oliver wrote a poem in 1986, which was published in New Irish Writing and subsequently in his own collection of poems, called The King's Shillings. And it was a very inspirational poem in the sense that it gave me a picture of what my grandfather, Francis Marshall, might have been like, and how he may have travelled from Kilkenny to Clonmel, having enlisted in the army in Kilkenny in 1892. I just stayed with that, but over the years, well, about 10 years exactly, I started researching my ancestry when I packed up working. And I discovered that it was a man called Frank Fraser who introduced me to the whole question of looking at my ancestry, and he rang me up. It's in the front, first page of the book. I won't repeat it all, but he just said, "Frank, I always knew you were a bloody chancer, and now I know why." He says, "Your grandmother, your great-grandmother, changed her age from 47 to 73 in 10 years in the two censuses." And he didn't tell me instantly why, but I learned shortly after that it was for the because of the introduction of pensions in 1908, and suddenly she was eligible for pensions. So how could you not fall under the spell of a lady like that? And she was the great matriarch of that family as far back as I have gone. I couldn't find her husband for a long time, but eventually I did. In the cold black of officialdom, I found it in the baptismal register in St. Patrick's Parish. And it went on from there. I discovered the family lived in Gooseberry Lane, New Building Lane, Vicar Street, and Green Street before that. And I still see their ghosts in those lanes. Gooseberry Lane is gone. It was up in the village, in Upper Patras Street, at the back of Philly Larkin's shop. So I'll leave them with you. I'll just briefly say about my grandfather, Paddy Kenrick, who was born in Feathert and lived a totally different life to my grandfather, who had spent 27 years in the British Army and served in India as well as South Africa. But Paddy Kenrick worked for the man in the big house, drove his car. The 1906 first registered car in South Tipperary, HI1, a Ford Gladiator. And he had many other jobs as well. He was a distinguished man of his time, but I knew him until the time I was 12, and he was quite old man, said very little in our kitchen. And it strikes me now that I am older than he was then. Out of which I'll say no more. It was interesting to contrast the difference in them. Kevin has spoken about my mother, a woman who influenced me greatly and for whom I had great respect and still have. And what he said about her trip to Mellory is reflected in the book in more places than one. My father was a quiet man, dedicated to his job as a postman in Clonmel, and to his God, and to Kilkenny Hurling. Out of loyalty to his father, he supported Kilkenny all his life, much to my dissatisfaction, but I had to honour him, but I never followed Kilkenny. But just to give you a measure of the kind of man he was and that dedication of to Kilkenny hurling, he cycled from Clonmel to Ballybrophy, which is roughly 50 miles, got on the train, went to Croke Park, watched Kilkenny playing, cycled back, came back by train to Ballybrophy and cycled all the way back to Clonmel. Another 50 miles, and then the following day got up on his bike and did a 26-mile trip out the road on his normal route. So there's no more needs to be said about him. I had intended to say something about Niamh here, but as I said, she came back from Vietnam unexpectedly, and she said, I don't want you talking about me. Let it in the book. Let it settle in the book. So I just briefly talk about Dave, who's still in Hanoi. I spoke to him on the phone today. He's doing well. I said to Heather on the phone on Monday night, you know, Niamh is home. She said she didn't. I said, Dave is out there now. He's probably a bit lonely. I know, Grandad. He can handle that, she said. So I just wanted to briefly summarise the story of Dave. He took me down to Key West. And we drove down his big old battered limousine. And the first night we were there, we got into the tourist mode and we went out on the Gulf of Mexico with enticements of free beer and the opportunity to see the sun setting in the Gulf of Mexico. It never set because it never came out. But they were dishing out the beer fairly liberally, and in the second offering, this chap came along and he said, where are you guys from? I said, we're Irish. And he said, do you live in Ireland still? And Dave said, no, my dad lives in Ireland. He said, I live in Palm Beach. And I remember distinctly at that particular moment, he was pouring beer from the jug he had into my glass. It stopped and it shook. And he stood back and he looked at me, he looked at both of us, and he said, your father and son? I said, yes. He said nothing, and then he said, I'm South African, and he disappeared. He didn't come back on any of the other rounds. It was pretty clear he thought we were a gay couple. And, do you know, I didn't think it was funny at the time. But I remember that the tourist literature said clearly, Key West has a swinging gay population. So it wasn't an unreasonable assumption he made. There is a twist in the story at the end of it, and I won't ruin it by telling you. So I'll let you enjoy the story. I move on briefly. Is it? A chapter called Serendipity. Certain person wasn't altogether too happy about my decision to read this. But I decided that I wanted to just talk about it. It was 1962, it was New Year's Eve. 1962 wasn't a great year for me at all. It emerges in the book. And I was never mad about Christmas Eve or New Year's Eve anyway, with all this false gaiety and what you have to do and pretend that you're in great form. And I didn't want to go, but my friend Tom Power said to me, himself and his girlfriend obviously had decided that I needed a female companion in my life. And a blind date was arranged for the tennis club in Island Bridge. I went reluctantly. I was introduced to this girl, pleasant girl, and we danced, and I didn't exactly cover myself in glory. I kind of left it, you know. I moved away. I didn't pursue it, if I could put it that way. I went back and I told Tom Power, and he said, you did what? You can't do that, he said. You can't walk away from this. So a lot more was said, but he said to me that he didn't say it. He intimated more or less, I need to be looking for another lift home. So I mooched around, and the place was crowded. And I saw this lady there, and I thought she was the best looking woman around in the hall. I went up and I asked her to dance. And she smiled at me, and we danced, and it was usual chit-chat, you know. We started talking about Christmas cards, of all things. It wasn't unreasonable in being shortly after Christmas. And we didn't exactly hit it off, folks, you know. At all, we didn't. So we could barely tolerate each other for the end of the dance, and we said cheerio. And that was it. I still had no lift. I was prevented from reading the rest, telling you the rest of the story, but I did get a lift home. I got as far as Rathmines, and then I had to walk home to Glasnevin, which was not an unusual thing on a Saturday night. So that was it until about 4 months afterwards. I was a dance up in Rathmines in Leinster Cricket Club, where I used to go most Saturday nights, and I saw, of all people, the lady of the Christmas cards. So I went up and I smiled at her this time, and I asked her for a dance, and she smiled back. And it didn't actually work out too badly. And it developed, in fact, and 50 years later, we're still together. So, and she's still smiling at me. And if you spend 50 years with me, to be able to smile after that is good. So I think I'm nearly there, folks. You'll be glad to hear. There was a lot of stuff I was going to talk about, but it's much better. The book is there. I'll let you discover it. And I'll leave it with you. There was one thing, actually. Kevin said something about running. It's actually mentioned in three chapters, and I was going to talk about the single-minded preoccupation of runners. It wasn't a very positive piece, and then Marie said to me, do you really want to do that? And she said, why don't you think of the good part of it? And she reminded me of our neighbour in Ballantyr, who said to me one day, she said, you know, ye make me weak on a Saturday morning. There's people coming from, going out from early age, and running gear, tennis rackets, bikes, and coming back, and it goes on all day. I just don't know how you do it. And what I suppose I'm trying to say is that I left that with my family, and it's not an excuse for all the time I spent playing squash and running and all the rest of it. I left it to them, and they're the better for it, and it has now gone into another generation with Kevin and Deirdre's children, who are here, as I said. So with that, I say thank you sincerely for being here and for taking the trouble to come out and to support the book. Thanks very much, folks.
Frank was telling me about his grandmother. She's quite a formidable lady and experienced a great deal of things, which kind of promoted me to do. This is a small sketch of his grandmother, which at the bottom says, Great Lady for the Prayers, because that's actually mentioned in the book. So, Frank, it's just a small token of your memory.
Sorry, folks, Andrew just reminded me there. I mean, he graciously surprised me by telling me about this when he came in this evening. I had no notion of it. And I actually left out the piece about my grandmother when I was talking to you, and it's very simple, actually. I painted a picture of my grandfather Francis coming home to the house in Clonmel and saying to her, the regiment has been posted to India again. She married him when she was 17, he was 36. And the point is this, she had my father as an infant in her hands. I just imagine this. I don't think she would have been asked, she wouldn't have had any say in it, but wives did accompany their husbands. And I describe her as sitting down, trying to come to terms with it. And I go on to say what happened. I mean, they went down, they went across to England, they went down the South Atlantic, into the Bay of Biscay. She had a toddler, as I said, and she was pregnant at the time. So she was just touching 19. And I have her concerned about what was going on, and then I describe the seasickness and the travails of pregnancy, and I leave that with you. But reading it during the week, I just said to myself, I wonder, is that right at all? I mean, it was my imagination. It did happen. She did go on. She spent 5 years there. And she had another child, and she had a miscarriage as well. But the point of it is that I said, maybe at 19 she was up for this. Wild with excitement to be heading off to India. It's something for the ladies to think about. Thanks, folks.
When it's not always raining, there'll be days like this. When there's no one complaining, there'll be days like this. Everything falls into place like the flick of a switch. Well, my mama told me there'll be days like this. When you don't need to worry, there'll be days like this. When no one's in a hurry.